Please welcome our great friend, Dr. Yuri Maltsev.
It's very nice to be home, very nice to be here. And it's not that I have something here, just to look professional. And I would say that what is in common between people like Lenin, like Stalin, like Hitler, like Dewey, Bernie Sanders, is that they have one hero, and this hero is Rudolf Ludwig Karl Virchow, the father of socialized medicine. He died in the beginning of the last century, and he used to say that medicine is a social science, and politics is nothing but medicine on a grand scale. So people should be treated for their mental diseases, and those who would not pass the test should be discarded. And one of his best students was Adolf Hitler, whose first law passed in Nazi Germany after he won elections, free elections, democratically won elections, was the law for the prevention of progeny and hereditary disease, and an intended to consolidate social and health policies and prohibit reproduction for persons defined as genetically inferior. After 1933, the connection between the theory and practice of Virchow became actual policy in Nazi Germany. Not many people realize that Nazi Germany was also a home of socialized medicine. Medicine is number one target for socialists of all kind, because I think that even they do understand the wisdom of John Locke. Locke, in the 17th century, he made the point of self-ownership. Who owns you, he would ask. Who owns you? Do you own yourself? And if you do own yourself, you're a free man. If you don't own yourself, you're a slave. And that's exactly what medicine, socialized medicine, is doing. It's turning everybody into slavery, into public slavery. Socialism is nothing but public slavery. And that's why it is the most deadly disease which ever was experienced by humankind. It dwarfs the plagues, it dwarfs cholera, it dwarfs everything else. Last century alone, according to Rudolf Rummel, a great American demographer, 260 million people were murdered by their socialist governments. The socialism, it's kind of like, to use medical terms, it's kind of a socialized AIDS. It destroys countries. It's highly contagious. Because the whole idea of, say, of the communists and the Soviet Union were to have a permanent revolution. They considered Soviet Union as a small motor, as a little motor, and then the big motor, the whole world, should be started in revolution through the transmission belts. Who would be the professional revolutionaries? That Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels in the manifesto of the Communist Party, they're writing that what is socialism? Socialism is abolition of private property, abolition of private property on everything, on yourself, on your possessions. So you become a slave, because a slave is the one who does not make choices. They make choices for you, and they make choices for you to live or not to live. I came from the country, from Soviet Union, which was the first in the field of socialized medicine. In Soviet Union, definitely, we cannot say that they didn't go far enough, or they didn't do much, or didn't have enough resources to implement socialized medicine. No, they did. And they treated masses, anywhere from 43 to 61 million people were murdered in the Soviet Union. Just Treating medicine as a social science, treating medicine as politics. Stalin himself, he used to say, we shouldn't spend too much time on reforming people. Much easier to make new ones. Can you imagine? This is the maximum evil that you can imagine. I'm working in the Library of Congress on the, some kind of archives, Soviet archives, which were hidden by certain General Volkogonov, who was a defector from Soviet Union, and he stashed everything in the Library of Congress. And U.S. Ambassador in Moscow wanted him to to turn them to the CIA. He said, no CIA, Library of Congress, and if the CIA wants to read them, let them come and get a reader's card. They didn't, but I did. And I think, the only one. And this is evil of enormous proportions. For example, recently I encountered this resolution by Lenin. There is a person is writing to Lenin, dear comrade Lenin, you told us to fight religious people, especially old ones. Because old ones are parasites. I mean, they don't contribute to society anymore. Comrade Lenin, you didn't explain us how to fight religion. Lenin is writing him back, dear comrade imbecile, murder religious people, that's how. And murder them the way that everybody will be trembling with fear 150 miles around. Soviet Union, I remember that when I lived there, the situation is a little bit improved after 25 years after they got rid of socialism. And in the field of socialized medicine, they also made some encroaches. Now you can buy private insurance there. Interestingly enough, that Minister for Health of today's Russia, he said, it's funny for us to see that United States want to move to the position which we so gladly abandoned. And that's exactly what it is. But I can just give you some statistics. Life expectancy at the last year of Soviet Union was 56 for men and 62 for women. Can you imagine? Corresponding numbers for United States are 77 and 84. So that means that not only the people were murdered in Gulag, not only people were shot in the basements of the KGB, the people were put to death in Soviet hospitals and clinics. And that was just the most amazing experience that I do remember. For example, I had when I was a kid, they took the tonsils, they had a surgery. And I noticed that there were two cats in the surgery. Now in the United States, definitely none of you would go to a surgery and go through the operating room where there are cats there. and that's the... So this was... And why that would be happening? Not only because the medical professionals were corrupt, and they were corrupt, because in the Soviet Union, the whole idea, if you have a socialized medicine, then you have a free medical education. And the idea is that we gave you education, so you owe us, not that you will get more. So the brain surgeon in the USSR would get about one third of the salary of the bus driver. And so this was the case. In all socialist countries, usually there was a saying that they pretend they're paying us and we pretend we're working for them. And exactly the same attitude was in hospitals. The same attitude was in hospitals. I came from the family of medical professionals. My sister, she is professor of immunology right now, University of Chicago. My mom, she was biochemist. My father, biophysicist. And all the time at home, around the dining table, I listened to these horror stories of what's going on in the hospitals. How the people who would not have money to give a bribe would die trying to reach the restroom after a serious surgery, because nobody would give them anything. There were a lot of, I remember a good friend of mine came from another city to Moscow, from Kazan, and he was robbed and mugged, and he ended up in a hospital, and because they found on him my phone number, so I was there right away. He had some very serious problem. That's the hinge of the skull was broken. And the hinge, it's in most cases, that would be a deadly kind of thing. And and the doctor, a young, nice doctor, he said, look, he has a very serious trauma. This is trauma that most people are dying. It's like about 75-80% mortality on this. And so he needs a lot of attention. And nobody will look into that because it's such a deadly thing. And then I realized that to translate it into plain language is that give me a bribe after, otherwise we will kill him. Nobody will look into that because mortality with this trauma is very high. And so I said, how much? And he said immediately 10,000 rubles. And so that's kind of what the black market, how the market, the distorted market would still find its way. We collected the money, we saved him, but that was the case. My relatives, all in the medical profession, they called it socialist veterinary, that the most doctors are not doctors, veterinarians. Veterinarians, because the people are cattle. People are cattle. People were expected. Why they were killing so many people? Not many people in the United States understand that. The reason why in all socialist countries they kill, and they will kill here if they will come to power, because socialism does not have absolutely any incentives. There are no incentives to do anything, because socialism, as you know, is equality of results. If results are being given as equal, you don't have any incentive to do anything. To make you to do what I want you to do, I need to threaten you. I need to threaten you and then to follow up with mass murders, with exiles, with tortures, and that's exactly what they did. And then if you have, as bad as disgusting as private slavery is, it doesn't make any sense to kill slaves, because slaves are your wealth, in private slavery. In public slavery, it's nobody's liability. It's not an asset for you, but in many cases, it's a liability. And that's why they would not treat, in most cases, if you are over 65, they would just be giving you aspirin for anything. There will be no surgeries, no much money done. And that was the case. And in all socialized medical systems, including the one in the United States, which Obamacare, we have different tiers. Obamacare is just the beginning, a gateway to socialized medicine. It's not yet socialized medicine. It's a gateway. However, if logically continued, we would end up in completely socialized medicine. But I remember when I began to work for Gorbachev's government as one of economic advisors, I wouldn't take the blame. I wasn't the advisor, and I did untrue in 11 time zones. But they immediately moved me from the level of gray masses to the level of the best and few and chosen, and so to the better tier. And even there, socialized medicine was appalling, because they put me in a hospital. They put me in a hospital, and I am in a hospital for a week, just to do tests. And I was thinking, come on, tests. I was really frightened. I thought there is something growing in me that I don't know. So I invited my doctor. She was, in the Soviet Union, we could say she looked beautiful. In U.S. Academy, you should say she looked optically superior or something. So I invited her for a dinner. And she didn't, she didn't know why. But at that time, I didn't have this capitalist accumulation, so I was twice younger. And so she probably thought something else. And I, my idea was to find out what's with me. And she said, come on, what's with you? You should understand. I mean, we have our plan targets that we reach are based on mortality and occupancy. So the hospital in the, in any planned economy, you need to put a target because there's no profit. Target, what are you doing? What's that for? And the target was to have a low mortality, high occupancy. Because if you have mortality with no occupancy target, then you'll have an empty hospital. So mortality, low mortality and high occupancy means that you should have a full hospital, but with healthy people. Because who can die, God forbid? That would be sick people. And so if somebody is really sick, they would say, go home, and there's a nice family circle. They will say goodbye to you. So this is the kind of the case. Hospitals also, say in Soviet Union, superpower number two, and for some in the United States, number one, 36%, because I had an access to classified statistics, 36% of hospitals in the Soviet Union did not have water supply or sewer system. Can you imagine? They do a surgery, then the nurse will go to the well, would pull up the bucket, they will, hopefully they will boil this water, she will prepare you for the surgery, and after surgery you need to go to the outhouse. So that was 36%. 52% of hospitals did not have running hot water. So there was no disposable syringes or disposable anything. 78% of people, of AIDS victims in Soviet Union got AIDS through dirty needles and tainted blood from the state-run hospitals. This is a free. In the United States, the proponents of socialized medicine, the major argument is that it's too expensive, that today we cannot afford it. And so we need to nationalize medicine. Medicine, healthcare is the largest industry in the United States. It's 18% healthcare of gross domestic product. 18% together with the industry of medical devices and pharmaceutical industry, it's almost one quarter of our economy. It's the biggest industry, and it will be the biggest providers of jobs for 25 years ahead. So then they want to take it over, and then they want to own you. That's what it is. And the argument is that it's too expensive. We cannot afford it. Well, Russians spent 18% of their income on booze. Maybe that's what we need. Instead of spending on healthcare, just increase the amount of booze spending. Then what is the reason that healthcare? Because of the great innovations there. Great innovation. For example, how much would you pay for a knee replacement, say, 25 years ago? Nothing, zilch. There was no such thing. Or hip replacement. Or bypass surgery 25 years ago. No such a thing. Now, each one of these surgeries is $75,000, $80,000, $100,000 per surgery. So, and I think that if the richest country in the world, that definitely it's a normal good, it's not inferior good, that you spend more the richer you are. So these are the kind of the issues. But the most important, I think, for me, is that medicine is you own your body. If government owns your body through socialized medicine, if they would decide that when you should die and where or who should live, then this is the end of everything. We already have public education, part of public slavery. And do we want the same politics of the school boards that to be introduced in healthcare when you should be zip coded to have a doctor? Because socialized medicine presumes a government monopoly. You would not have any kind of even a chance to have a choice. And if you would be assigned to a butcher, then the butcher would be butchering. And this is the most amazing for me to see how people, how happily they want to give up freedom that they have. This, This is very sad. And I think that this is the front line of everything. Right, well, thank you. I think I depressed you enough.